anyone in church. Praise the Lord. So I have been away on leave. That's why I was missing in action from the church. And so I came back this week, and this team decided to put me on the pulpit. Don't even give me any time to acclimatize myself. But it gives me so much joy to be bringing to you the word of God today. But before I tell you what it's all about, allow me to share a little personal story. When I was made senior pastor in 2020, I had one of you, you know, a member of this church, you know, come up to me, you know, and they told me, yeah, congratulations, you know, and so on. And they told me, okay, three things you need to watch out for. Okay, they called them three G's. Okay, that was memorable. I'm so glad they put it like that. You know, he told me, these are the three G's. Here's the first one. Girls. Okay? It's like, okay, wow, thanks. Second one was gold. Okay? Careful about the gold, the money, and so on. And third one, they told me, was glory. Okay, so girls, gold, and glory. Just, you know, it was very good advice. You must agree, right? And I was like, hey, guys, in this church are deep. You know, I was being ministered to and I was helped. And I have tried to, you know, think and watch those pitfalls. In fact, MI3 had a meeting not so long ago, like 2 months ago. And this was actually the subject they were looking at, you know, the pitfalls that men face. And those three were actually somehow included in there as they were looking at the story of Joseph. But for myself, like 2 years in the ministry, you know, this role, somebody else showed me that it is not just three G's, but 4 S. Okay. You know this thing, this proverb sometimes that read three things that the Lord hates. Even 4 that he detests, you know, and the 4th one will shock you. That kind of thing. Okay, so here's the 4 S. And they're sort of like, the first three are sort of like the same with the three G's. Okay, just say it differently. The 4 S, this is the first S. The first S is sex. Okay? Second S, and some of you are like, Pastor, please expound these things. The second S is it's just like this other side. Gold is silver. Okay, sex, silver. And the third one is self. Okay, and I think that has correspondence with glory on the other side. Here's the last one. The last S to watch out for was sloth. Slothfulness. Or being lazy. Or being a sluggard. Watch out. So these are pitfalls that affect not just pastors, but men and women everywhere. And you need to watch out for those 4 things, the 4 S's. And so for me, I found that last one to be very interesting because I rarely get to hear about it. And that is going to be the subject of our conversation here today. Slothfulness, being a sluggard, or laziness. And the book of Proverbs talks a lot about this. In fact, I tried to count places in the book of Proverbs that just mentions laziness or sluggard, and I found 26 places. By the way, I wasn't counting, this was just lazy or sluggard. I didn't count the ones that have other related words like sleep. If I included everything, there would be a lot more than this. And this is just the book of Proverbs only. I didn't go into other books. Bible has a lot to say on this topic. Top of my head, I remember what Paul was telling the Thessalonians, remember, both 1st and 2nd Thessalonians. He who does not work should not eat. What Paul was telling Timothy, 1 Timothy, I think chapter 5, the context was addressing widows. You know, some widows who, you know, were coming to the church, you know, to seek support. But some of them were lazy and they were becoming busybodies and so on. He was saying they should put their religion to practice and provide for their own family. He says, he who does not provide for his own families has denied the faith and is worse off than an unbeliever. Bible has a lot to say on this topic. And I believe then that it is a conversation worth having. And so the text that I chose for today's sermon is Proverbs 26, verse 12 to 16. And I want us to turn there. Proverbs 26. I know you guys knew we were in the book of Proverbs, so you're already there. Okay, so I can read. Proverbs 26, 12 to 16. Verse 12 says, "Do you see a person wise in their own eyes? There is more hope for a fool than for them. A sluggard says, 'There is a lion on the road, a fierce lion roaming the streets.' Verse 14, as a door turns on its hinges, so a sluggard turns on his bed. A sluggard buries his hand in the dish. He is too lazy to bring it back to his mouth. A sluggard is wiser in his own eyes than seven people who answer discreetly." That's how it ends. So, I have divided my sermon into three parts, just to make it easy. The first part, I'm going to talk about what I call the goodness of work, because I want to show you, why is this problem an issue, problem of laziness? So first point is the goodness of work. Second point is the description of a lazy person or the characteristics of a lazy person. And then the last one is the dangers of laziness. So just put your finger on the Proverbs that we read. We're going to come back to it. But right now, I want us to look at the goodness of work. And I want to say that laziness is a problem because work is good. I know some people think that work came about as a result of the fall. You know, when our first parents sinned, you know, and they were kicked out of the garden, and God has said, "You know, out of the sweat of your brow shall you eat, you know, and thorns and thistles will come up to you." And they were kicked out of that garden, and now we have to fend for ourselves and so on. Some people even imagine if we were still in that garden. You know, we were there, a cappella, we're naked. You know, all just need to do is just choose your own tree. You sit down there, we'll just be eating some of this nice, what nature has to offer, and we enjoy nature, we sleep, you know, and we hang out with our friends. Some of us think that is what, that's how we were meant to be. You're mistaken. You see, Genesis 1 begins with God at work. In the beginning, how does it say? God created the heavens and the earth. And Genesis chapter 1, he just continues to tell us, you know, how God went about his creation. Day 1, this is what he did. 2, this is what he did. God is at work. In fact, we want to say that God is our example of diligence, of creativity, of initiative, and of excellence. And God would finish creating something and he would step back and he would examine it. He would evaluate it and say, this is good. That's why I'm saying that God is even our example of excellence and initiative, hard work. He would take time to rest after his work in the end. But before he did this on the sixth day, God created man in his own image and likeness as the pinnacle of all his creation. And then he gave him the mandate to continue with the work that he had just begun. Right there, before the fall, God gave man work to do. And here are Bible verses to back this up. Genesis chapter 1, verse 28. It says that God blessed them and he said, "Be fruitful and increase in number." That is a lot of work. "Fill the earth and subdue it." Okay? "Rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky and over every living creature that moves on the ground. Be fruitful and multiply and rule over all these creatures that I've given you guys." Genesis chapter 2, verse 15. It says, "The Lord God took the man and he put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and to take care of it." To do what? To work it. It is work that man was being given to do. This is before the fall. Genesis chapter 2 verse 20, it says, "So man gave names to all the livestock, the birds in the sky, and all the wild animals." So man went about the work of naming the animals. We are told that God never named all these animals. In fact, he created and he brought them to man to see what he would name them. This was our responsibility. Gave the names to the animals. It says, "But for Adam, no suitable helper was found." Now let me ask you, Do you think the helper was being found for a man whose job was just to wake up, to sit, to eat, to enjoy nature, to sleep, repeat? You think that kind of person needs a helper? He needed a helper because there was a lot of work to do. And God looked at him and was like, he was not going to do it by himself. And there's a lot that can be said about this, but let's move on to the New Testament. The New Testament in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10 says that we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works for which God prepared in advance for us to do. He says that God has work for us to do. And we were created in Christ Jesus for something. And I can tell you, I do not know whether there is an exception to this rule. I do not know whether there is somebody who is God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus, but God does not have work for them to do. If you are there and you are an exception to this rule, okay, you are such a curious creature, you should be somewhere in a museum for us to see. Because you're such a rare species. Somebody who God just created, you know, with nothing to do. Friends, what I'm trying to say is that work is good. And we all have work to do. That's what makes laziness such a problem. Which brings me to my second point, the description of a lazy person. I want us to go back to the Proverbs that we read, Proverbs chapter 26. Verse 12, it says, do you see a person who is wise in their own eyes? There is more hope for a fool than for them. Okay, we will come back to that. But I want us to start with verse 13. He says that a sluggard says, there is a lion in the road, a fierce lion roaming the streets. What does that sound like to you? In the earlier service, we had Pastor John Agagwa say, you know, somebody who lives in Rungai. I don't think we should be trying to hurt people's feelings in church, you know? But to me, it sounds like an excuse, right? There's a lion out there, there's a lion in the streets. I'm like, first of all, have you ever seen a lion on the road? A lion on the streets. It is a very rare occurrence. Even for you guys who live in Rungai. Okay, Rungai is a special a lion zone. Except for you guys who live in Rungai. But even, to be fair, even for you guys who live in Rungai, those videos that you guys were sharing of lions in your streets where people live, it was at night when people should be sleeping. Okay, that's a good time for lions to roam around. Because it's not the time for us to be out working. It is a very rare occurrence. I wish this person had said, you know, there is a dog on the road, a fierce dog, you know, in the streets. That would have been more believable. But a lion, that's so rare. So, even his worries are not practical. Secondly, there was an overemphasis on the lion. Okay, I couldn't help but notice. It's not just that there's a lion out there, but there is a fierce lion. I'm like, why are you over-describing the lion? Okay, you know, for me, I've never even met a timid lion. Have you ever met a timid lion? For me, the word lion, it already has, you know, fierce already pre-bundled in it. It sort of feels to me like if you say fierce lion, you're repeating yourself. You know, there are some types of people who, they only see threats, they are only inclined to see danger, what cannot be done, trouble, that's all they see. You know, this strategy of, you know, I don't think they call it SWOT analysis, you know, where you look at, objectively, at strength, you know, weaknesses, you know, opportunities and threats, you know, and you try to balance things, these things out. There's some people, other people who only see threats, only see trouble. Oh, hey, you guys are not seeing that lion out there. That's all that they see. They hardly see opportunities. In fact, some commentators say that this laggard actually saw two lions. You know, this is the second time this verse is being repeated. This verse had come up earlier for there's a lion out there. Now, there's a lion on the road, there's a lion on the streets. It's probably not even one lion that he's seeing. And that word streets. Some of your translations say in the open square. Open square was actually a place for business, was a place for commerce, was a place for exerting yourself. And this person, where people do business, is where he was saying, there is a lion out there, so I can't go there. Cannot see the opportunity, only sees the threat. Forgets that God says, do not fear, for I will be with you. I will help you. I will strengthen you. I will uphold you with my right, righteous, omnipotent hand. God has given us promises, my friends. He says, go out there. I will be with you. Forgets that. Only sees danger. Only sees the reason why he can't try it out. Why I can't risk this. So the first description of a lazy person is that they give excuses. Here's a second description of a lazy person, a characteristics of a lazy person. Verse 14. I called it, they are enslaved to their comforts. And this is what verse 14 says. It says, as the door turns on its hinges, so a sluggard turns on his bed. As a door turns on its hinges, so a sluggard turns in his bed. You know, one of the things about the door? Yeah, the door just turns and moves like this. This way and that way. But do you realize the door never moves? The door never goes anywhere. I think I can put it like that. The door never goes anywhere, right? Because the door is screwed on the hinge on the frame. It is stuck there. It cannot move beyond there. In fact, one of you could argue that the door is a slave to the hinge. The hinge determines, you know, how far the door will go. It never makes any progress. Stays in one place. And the proverb says, so does the sluggard. He's tied to his bed. He only moves like this, you know, and then turning like this when he wants to change positions. Very good at sleeping. Bed is his slave. In fact, somebody made a joke and he said, the sluggard is so good at sleeping, he can actually do it with his eyes closed. And I can't help but agree. The bed is his master. And I believe here that bed can be metaphorical for anything that enslaves you and makes you not move forward. It doesn't have to be like a physical bed. It can be anything else. It can even be a couch. I remember this cartoon called Handicap. You know, Handicap is always sleeping on a couch. You know, just drives his wife Flo crazy. Some of you, maybe it's the couch and Netflix. Uh-huh. You never move. Netflix. You can stay there for a whole day watching an entire series. 25 episodes, 25 hours. You watch them in 24 hours. I don't even know how you do it. I just don't know. The only moving you do to the toilet, even that, you don't do it so often. But you move from one series to another series. Okay? Or some of you, it's social media. Okay? And you're just like this. This is your hinge. This is your hinge is over here. Okay? Because you're just like this. This is all the movement that you do. You know, as you move from profile to profile, or from one short video to another. Just a waste of time. You just... because you're fixated on these things. I believe that, you know, bed here can stand for things that we are fixated on, things that waste our time, and they make us just make no progress at all. Those things have become a door hinge for you, or like the sluggard's bed. Be very careful of being enslaved by things that rob you of your time and of your productivity. Sluggards, they are enslaved by their comforts. Okay, here's number three. Lazy people are unable to grab even what is within their reach. Lazy people are unable to grab even what is within their reach. This is what verse 15 says. It says, a sluggard buries his hand in the dish, and then he's too lazy to bring it back to his mouth. This verse is actually repeated two times in the book of Proverbs. The other time was in chapter 19, verse 24. Something is within their reach, but they will just not seize it. So the sluggard will go hungry not because there is no food, but because they lack the discipline to finish what they started and to grab something that is within their reach. Now, I know a man some time back who was jobless. And he borrowed people money so that he could get by. I sort of knew him well, you know, and I would be one of these people that he would come to from time to time. So this one time I had a conversation with him like, yo, because in my view was, I find that it is more dignified if he found something to do, because I felt like there was more dignity in doing work than what he was doing on a regular, you know, seeking people out, his friends out, so that they could bail him out. And so we even actually had a long conversation. We spent some time together. We went through a list of things that he could do. You know, there were suggestions made here and there, and we checked out different things. But you know, some of the things that we checked out, the jobs that we checked out, some of them he said, okay, this one is beneath me. Others he said, no, this one requires too much effort. So I don't think this is the kind of thing that I can do. And so in the end, he was actually not able to do any of these things, which in my opinion, and his own opinion as well, these things were within reach, but there was just that reason why he was not able to do any of these things. And so he went back again to his own thing of just borrowing guys' money. I was completely... I don't know what to say. I mean, for me, I was like, my goodness, I thought, especially these things that he was saying are beneath me, I thought it is more dignified to do something that you feel is not of your stature. I don't know how to put it. I feel like there's more dignity to be able to earn something with your own hands, right? What do you mean this thing is beneath you? But the borrowing is not beneath you. This is the thing that you do on a regular. You get what I'm saying? He had his own private logic that I did not understand. Now, I do not know who this is for, but I want to say two things. First, finish what you start. Finish what you start. Have you started something? Are you on course with it, or have you just abandoned it somewhere? And what reason do you have to give for doing so? Is it procrastination? Procrastinating. And some of you, perhaps you started out on something very good. Maybe it's something school-related. You know, because you know if you do this thing, it might actually enhance your skills and maybe it make you much better. But we leave so many things because I feel like as a society we are used to procrastination. We'll just not finish what we started. This person, he puts his hand under the dish, but he will not do what? Bring it back to himself. And I feel like for the most of us, we have made it this far by the grace of God. If you consider that we have perfected the art of procrastination, this is how we started out, you know, in our school days. You know, we will just do whatever we want. Hey, the term is going. Then exam time. That's, we prepared for exam time very last minute, right? We know a thing or two about transnighting, burning the midnight oil. It's by the grace of God that we did well. This is how you're trying to do your life today. At work, they need you to give regular reports, but you wait until the very last minute. You know, the last day is when you're calling your colleagues, hey, by the way, what happened? Did you send me your information? That's when you're trying to compile together your report. And you hand in substandard work. Even you know sometimes, I could have done better if I put in more time to it. So other times you miss the deadline by a mile. And you keep getting into trouble for this. Procrastination. Then we update our CVs and we write there, we work well under pressure. Sometimes you need to interrogate, which pressure is this that you're talking about? I find that sometimes this pressure is self-inflicted pressure, right? There's no pressure in the world. But you create pressure for yourself. HR practitioners, every time you see this thing, I work well under pressure, ask this person, okay? Do you mean you have perfected the art of procrastination? Is that what you're talking about? You know, what do you mean really by this? That's the first one. Finish what you start. Pace yourself. And fight against the inclination to put it off until some other time. In fact, I want to say this. Procrastination, I don't know whether it is a child of laziness or whether they are siblings. All I know is that they are related. Second thing I want to say, I don't know who I'm saying this to. Seize the opportunities that are already available to you. And especially those of you who have been, perhaps, let's say, out of a job for a very long time. I know that you do not have the privilege that some other people do have. You know, those of you who maybe you're just out of a job, maybe this year. So you still have the time. You can wait a bit. You can choose. You can be a bit choosy, you know, what you want and that kind of thing. But if you have been out for a very long time, I think it is okay to go even on survival mode. And I want to be very careful as I say this. And I know that there are some of you perhaps who this is your circumstance. Maybe you really are trying, and I applaud you for that, and may God continue to give you grace. But I want to add something to it and say, if the thing that you're looking for, your preferred profession, the profession that you like, the kind of jobs that you like, are not forthcoming, imagine it's okay to consider also the next best thing. Look at what is within your reach, my friends, and consider it. And don't say, you know, I don't like this food. Maybe that's what he was saying, the person who put his hand under the dish. I don't like this food. Okay, is starvation an option for you? Eat this food for survival, right? A time will come when that gourmet dish that you usually like perhaps will come. This is a stepping stone to that one. Why starve? Why go hungry when it is within your reach, this thing? It might not be the best, it might not be what you want. And others who insist, you know, me, I'm a white collar type of guy. And so when blue collar opportunities come knocking, you know, just let them pass by. You know, there's this program on TV. I don't know whether you guys know it. It's called, I do watch it from time to time when I have the free time. It's called Njoro wa Uber. You know, any of you know that one? Njoro was a banker. Okay, I think he was an accountant or something like that. Something happened at his place of work. And so Njoro lost his job. Okay, something that he was contesting, you know, the whole story went to court. But while he was waiting for those matters to be resolved, rather than, you know, lays at home, you know, feeling sorry for himself, Njoro decided to do what? Start an Uber business. There's a banker. Started, hey, me, I have a car. Okay, I'll start doing Uber. That was a very relatable story. The first time I saw it, I was like, it actually makes a lot of sense. Very interesting story. In fact, I feel it's one of the most relatable shows that are out there on TV. I want to draw your attention to Jesus Christ as well. And especially those of you who say, you know, me, I'm a white-collar type of guy. You know, this is all blue-collar stuff. You know. Okay, let's look at Jesus. You know, one of the things I like about the story of Jesus is that, you know, Jesus did not come as one of these super famous philosophers. Jesus came in a time when they were like Greece, in Greece. You know, there were those legend philosophers. You remember them? And I think he could outmatch any of some of those guys. But that's not the profession he came with. Jesus did not come as one of these decorated military officers. You know, like those Roman legends, Akina, some of those Roman soldiers, you know, who were famous for war. He didn't come as one of those guys. Do you know the profession Jesus came with? He was a what? He was a carpenter. He was fundi wa mbao. For crying out loud, you know, remember that song? Think about it for a moment. This is the Son of God. I mean, are you more sophisticated than the Son of God? You know, I mean, for Jesus, you know, blue collar could suit him, but for me, you know, blue collar, I mean, oh, come on. Think about Paul. We could say that Paul was arguably one of the smartest people who ever walked on the face of this earth. You agree? I mean, people go and do PhDs to become professors so that they can know how to chambua what he was writing. Very brilliant man, person. But when he wasn't getting the support for his ministry, you know, because there are times when he would find support so that he would commit most of his time to just purely the work of ministry. When he didn't have that support, guess what work he was doing? Tent making. Friends, that was manual job. In fact, that's what he would say to the Thessalonians when he said, by the way, I've set an example for you guys. Because there's some of you guys out here who don't like doing anything. He who does not work should not eat. He said, I'm setting an example for you guys. I wake up early morning and you see me stepping out and I use my hands. And I provide for myself. So, friends, what I'm trying to say in conclusion is do not be too choosy. Don't also give too many excuses. Don't even over-spiritualize. You know, I'm waiting for my breakthrough. Okay, fine. As we're waiting for this breakthrough of yours, okay, because it has been now, 5 years, 10 years? Okay, you still wait for your breakthrough, but while you're waiting for your breakthrough, do the next best. Let your breakthrough find you engaged, busy, working with your hands. And I tell you, God does look at these things. Be faithful in little, he says. It is D.L. Moody who said, a lot of people like to do great things for God, but few even consider to do the little things, he said. Blaise Pascal, a French mathematician, he said, this is his prayer, he said, God, help me to do great things as though they were little because I do them in your strength. And help me to do little things as if they were great because I do them in your name. God, if this little is what you have brought to me in this season, help me to do it with my head held high because I do it in your name. Amen. Okay, here's the last characteristic of a lazy person. We see it right there in verse 16. They are wise in their own eyes. It says that a sluggard is wiser in their own eyes than seven people who answer discreetly. Okay, they are wiser than seven people. If you've been in the Bible long enough, you know that seven is actually a symbolic number of perfection in the Bible. It says, this guy is wiser than seven people who are able to answer discreetly. It tells you that this person is so committed to his private logic that they don't think they cannot listen to anyone. They are wiser than everybody. They can't be advised. You guys just do not understand how unique their situation is. Only they have the knowledge or they have their wisdom to understand why they do this or they don't do that and so on. And they cannot be advised by anybody. Though the seven of you, everybody can see right through their issue, then they think differently. You see this thing that we were talking about that they were saying earlier, oh, there's a lion out there in the streets. That they're not saying it for you. Sir, you don't see the lion. Okay, you don't. But for me, I know there's a lion out there. They're saying it for themselves. They don't care what you think. They are close to you guys. They are wise in their own eyes, it says. They are not humble enough to listen to advice and so cannot be helped. For you see, friends, laziness most times is just a concealed form of pride. Laziness is pride in disguise. That's what it really is at the end of the day. It's pride in disguise, a veiled form of pride. And verse 12, that verse I said we'll come back to earlier on. Verse 5 says, do you see somebody who is wise in their own eyes? It says that there is more hope for a fool than for him. You know, the first time I read that, I was like, what are you talking about? I thought the fool was the bad guy in the book of Proverbs. You want to tell me there is one who is worse than this? The fool? It says there's actually hope for the fool. The person who is wise in their own eyes. And we're told here in verse 16, yeah, the sloth, the sluggard, he's wise in his own eyes. There is more hope for a fool than for that person. Friends, even foolishness has degrees. And this one is the worst form. Apparently. So friends, I think if you are inclined towards laziness, then you are at a very precarious place. This is completely dangerous. If there is more hope for a fool than for this person, I think this is dangerous and it ought to be addressed. Which brings me to my last point, and I will say it very quickly. The danger of laziness. If you are inclined towards laziness, then these three things might befall you because they are repeated a lot, many times in the book of Proverbs. And we do not have the time to go through all these verses. But I'll mention the three things. Poverty, hunger, and even death. I'll say Proverbs 6, verse 10, which says, a little sleep, a little slumber, a little folding of hands to rest. And what will happen to you? Poverty will come upon you like a bandit, scarcity like an armed man. It says, oh, you're in a very dangerous place. This thing will hurt you. This thing is dangerous to you. The Bible tries to say. But for me, the greatest danger of it all, I wrote, you are in danger because God will hold you to account in the end for your actions. God will hold you responsible at the end of the age when we will be told, we will have to give an account for our lives. You will have to answer for this. Why? Because God gave us the mandate to be fruitful and to multiply and to work. As it says in the book of Ephesians chapter 2, he prepared some things in advance for us to do. We know it says in Deuteronomy that he gives us the ability to make wealth. It says in the scriptures that God gives us different gifts and abilities for the common edification of all and for the glory and honor of his name. So if you do not cultivate your gifts, guess what you do? You impoverish society and you rob God of his glory. And you will have to give an answer to that. I remember the parable of the talents. Matthew chapter 25, verse 24. You know, the sluggard in their midst was given one talent, you know, which actually goes to show you that God recognizes that different people have different abilities. It's not, he doesn't all look at us all the same way. Some he gives 10, others he gave 5, others 1. God recognizes that. It's about how you perform according to your ability. But guess what the sluggard did? He didn't even perform at all. He did nothing at all. He was wise in his own eyes. He went and he hid that talent when his master appeared. This is what he said, verse 24 of Matthew chapter 25. He says, Master, I know you to be a hard man, reaping where you did not sow and gathering where you have not scattered seed. Oh, first of all, I was like, okay, wow. You are wise to say these things to your master. So I was afraid, verse 25, and I went and I hid your talent on the ground. Here, have what is yours. Chapter 26, verse 26, sorry. But his master answered him, you wicked and slothful servant. See what it's called? Wicked and slothful. He says, you knew that I reap where I have not sown, and I gather where I scatter no seed. Then you ought to have invested my money with the bankers, and at my coming I should have received what was my own with interest. In other words, he's like, he calls out this flawed logic of his. If you knew these things about me, then why didn't you do something about it? He says this, verse 27, says, sorry, verse 28. He says, so take the talent from him and give it to him who has 10 talents. For to everyone who has will be given more, and he will have an abundance. But from the one who has not, even what he has will be taken away. Verse 30, and cast the worthless servant into the outer darkness, in that place where there is weeping and gnashing of teeth. I think that sounds serious, my friends. I don't know about you, but this sounds serious to me. And the reason why we are addressing this topic is because this is a gospel issue. There are real consequences to this. And that's why I want, very finally, to lead you to the cross of Christ. We said earlier on that work is good. And I want to add that work was meant to be satisfying and fulfilling. But the reason why it is not like that, the reason why work for some of you is, you know, a traumatic experience, is because something happened in the very beginning in that garden. When Adam and Eve rebelled against God, that thing that we call the fall of man, there was a curse that was put, you know, into the world. Romans chapter 8 talks about how creation has been subjected to futility. Creation has been subjected to frustration. Creation groans. And I believe that when your body is inclined towards laziness, when your mind early in the morning on Monday, when you try to wake up, it just refuses to agree with you. I feel like it's just your body's way of telling you something is wrong with this world. And I want to agree with your body. It's true. It's right. Something is wrong. Something happened. It is not meant to be like this. We're meant to be like right now on Sunday. We're meant to be looking at Mondays like, Monday is coming. You know those memes for weekend is here. We're supposed to be thinking like that about Monday. Something is wrong with us, my friends. We are fallen beings. But my friends, there is hope, because that is why Jesus Christ came to die. On the cross, we see the curse lifted. On the cross, we see God addressing the issue. The Son of Man was sent so that he could pay the price. Because of Jesus, we now have hope that this will not be our experience forever. A time shall come when God shall make all things new. A time will come when you will delight in work. I'm one of those people who believes that part of creation being again part of the new heaven and new earth is that we will actually love partnering with God in doing things. And it can begin today. It can begin today when you allow the Son of God to come into your life and transform you. This is what Jesus came to address. In fact, I want to say that any solution that addresses the problem of laziness that bypasses or circumvents the cross is actually a gross underestimation of the problem. Because I've said the problem is the fall. And I can tell you, no therapist can even address the issue of the fall. Only Christ can address that. The solution must first start with the cross of Christ. The problem is not just behavior. The problem is this rot in our nature. And God wants to begin to deal with it here and now. Come to the cross and find forgiveness. Come to the cross and get a new nature. Come to the cross and start afresh with the Lord. Let the Son of God, who never shrank upon the work that God gave him. You remember? His work was to come and die. He didn't shrink from it. He faced it head on. If that one is living in you, then you will not shrink in any work that the Lord has set before you. He said to his disciples, I must go about my master's business. If that one is the one who is living in you, then what can you not do? Come to the cross. That's where our fight with laziness begins. And when we come again to the Lord Jesus Christ again and again, and we say, help me to become like yourself. Forgive me of this inclination within me to walk away from your work. Friends, let us go to the cross. Amen. Let us pray. Dear Lord, I know that you know us very well. And I'm so glad that you do not condemn us, but that your inclination is to help us. Your word says that we do not have a high priest on high who does not sympathize with us in our weaknesses, but we have one who was tested in every way like ourselves, yet we did not sin. God, we take it that to mean that you know the struggle of laziness. Though you, Jesus, were never guilty of it, but you know the experience. And even as you were able to overcome it, how I pray that you would help us to overcome it. We repent of this inclination within us to have things easy. We repent this inclination within us to procrastinate, to put important things off, to not want to do anything. We repent that we have not become like you. Have mercy upon us. And I pray that you would begin with us afresh. We know that the problem is not just behavior, but this rot in our nature. We pray that you would do a radical surgery in our heart. That you would give us a new attitude. That you would help us not to conform any longer to the patterns of this world, but transform us by renewing our mind. And help us to discern what your will is, your will which is good, pleasing, and perfect, and to do it. Let your kingdom come, let your will be done here on earth as it is in heaven. Show us what it is that you're doing in the world and how we can partner with you. Help us to be diligent and zealous in whatever professions it is that you have given us. And I pray, Lord, that in all things we'll bring glory and honor to your name. I pray, Lord, for somebody in here who has not given their lives to you. I pray that as long as it's called today, that they would start with you. They would open their hearts to you. They would make you Lord and Savior over their lives. And they would begin this journey of enjoying hard work and doing everything for the glory and honor of your name. For it is in Jesus' name we pray.